thing. This is the Planning and Zoning Commission for the Village of Vernon Hills. We need to start with a roll call.
Chairman Morris?
Here.
Commissioner Ballou?
Present.
Commissioner Cotton? Commissioner Hezner?
Here.
Commissioner Heidner?
Here.
Commissioner Mulchrone?
Here.
Commissioner Groag?
Okay. Okay, we have a quorum. This evening, we have continuation of the public hearing for case 1602 Woodland Chase Development. Being considered is the approval of certain variations pertaining to FAR, final site and landscape plan approvals, and preliminary and final approval of the architectural elevations and signage plans. Okay, so who's going to speak this evening on behalf of the petitioner?
That will be me, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Just you or anybody else?
Just me.
Okay. Okay. I believe last time you were sworn under oath, so that's still in effect?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You are on, as they say.
Good. As you may recall, we appeared before this board on February 24th, and I thought the meeting went very well. We heard a lot of very productive comments, and I'm pleased to report tonight that we were able to address most, if not all, of those comments. So my presentation will be relatively brief, and I'll be prepared to answer any questions you might have regarding that event over the last month and a half.
Okay. Seems like yesterday.
It was just like yesterday. The project location, total area of assembled properties, you may recall, is 32 acres at the southwest corner of Illinois Route 45 and Buffalo Grove Road. The project summary, the proposed master plan is a resulting assemblage of three key parcels: the Cicillo property, the Martin property, and the Condisec property. The collective properties are in Lake County and will require annexation into the village. On February 24th, as I indicated, we appeared before this plan commission and received approval for our project, including special use permit and certain variations. There were concerns that were raised, and in that time, we've had an opportunity to work with staff, as indicated, and we have solutions for each. The first that was raised by one of the plan commission members was light pollution from heavy traffic at the intersection of Buffalo Grove and Route 45, especially for those that the lots that are adjacent to that intersection. Our proposed solution is to the berm will be enhanced with thick growing evergreens and complementing plant materials. In addition, we're going to add a 6-foot fence to that perimeter, and that will run at the center of that berm all the way down Route 45 and down Buffalo Grove Road. Trail system is too close to the property. This is another concern that was raised. And frankly, it wasn't raised so much by the Plan Commission as it was by the cemetery itself. We communicated with their attorneys and their representatives, and our solution was to simply remove the trail from that perimeter. And as a result, it allowed us to preserve more trees, and we will be planting additional plant material along there in the form of evergreens and so forth. They wanted us to plant all evergreens, but we felt that was not a natural look. And since we're removing the trail, we wanted to have a more natural screening. In addition, that trail that I referenced, and I see you've got a laser here. We had the trail running all the way around the property and connecting with the sidewalk. And you don't see the, okay.
Use the cursor, might help us.
A cursor? Okay.
Yeah. Okay. If you could, thank you.
I really like that. My cat likes the laser.
Right.
you may recall we had a trail that was proposed around the perimeter of the property here, and it was going to connect to the sidewalk system that we also talked about. The result is that we now have the trail access here, which it was before, and it will now go around the pond. And frankly, we'd have to put a trail access around the pond anyways, because there's perpetual maintenance of that pond over time. You have to have access to it. In addition to that, we're going to provide an easement. We'll work with staff to provide some kind of an easement that will allow future connection of that trail to the township property if and when they ever put a trail in across the bridge. Another concern that was raised, exposure of future homes to the south property owners, Mr. and Mrs. Brickenhoff's existing home and view corridors. That was a part of discussion at the last meeting. We have been working with staff and with the Brickenhoff's consultants and representatives. And the result has been that, the solution is to install trees in a berm along the south property. We were concerned about taking out quality trees, and as it turns out, the trees, in fact, were not all that good. And for us, it really didn't matter. And candidly, we didn't want to look at their garage any more than they wanted to look at our houses. So it was a mutual benefit in this regard. So we're working with their consultants to design that berm so that it does provide adequate screening. Lots may be too small for proposed housing product based on current FAR. We established a matrix identifying the maximum FAR for each lot based on location and relationship. The board suggested we to provide an individual analysis of each lot. We work with staff to establish that matrix, and you have that in your packet. We were asked not to exceed 47%, which I believe we have not. And in fact, in some cases, we provided a little more stringent requirement based on its location. For example, the houses that back up to Route 45 and to Buffalo Grove Road might be slightly smaller to avoid having bulky looking houses along that perimeter. Concern, how do we protect the most trees and preserve the natural woodland character of the property? Solution, create a tree disturbance plan that identifies the location and quality of those trees that will either be removed or for proposed improvements, potentially impacted by home construction and protected by open space conservancies. We created a tree disturbance plan, which I'm used to having to do with many communities. And because we had a tree analysis, we were able to, and it's not an easy thing to look at 1,900 trees and code them, but we coded them with white, yellow, and mauve, pink. And the red were trees that would be removed, and almost all of those trees are trees that are in the yellow or beige area for site improvements like roads and detention ponds and sanitary sewers and so forth. The dark green are the trees that would be protected by open space. And the center area, you may recall, it's a little bit open, so we're working with urban forest management and staff to reforest that area and create an oak savanna. In fact, there's a whole process in that. The area to the south, which are the high quality wetlands, would be protected and enhanced. What that means is that we would go in and clear out all the non-native species, remove any plant material that's dead, and even prune back some of the trees so that they have a higher degree of success for survival. There would be trees planted around the pond in the form of reforestation of those areas. That would be reflected on our landscape plan. We have submitted a landscape plan for staff review, and we recognize that that plan would have to be tweaked and refined before final approval would be granted. The lighter green areas are essentially where the lots or the houses are going to go. Now, of course, the houses aren't going to go in the entire area, but I could have just said we're going to randomly clean out that whole area. What our preference was to identify those trees that were good and fair. And by the way, most of the trees on this property are fair condition. I learned that the only trees that ever get an excellent rating, and there are no excellent rated trees in here, are usually under 6 inches. Once they get over 12 inches, it's just a varying degree of stress to the tree. But there are some good trees in here, the yellow being the fair trees. There are a few good trees. Again, they're all under 12 inches. Having said all of that, when you start building houses, there's going to be stress on these trees. And it was disingenuous for us to sit here today or at any time and suggest that we're going to preserve every tree that's reflected on here. Clearly, the trees that are in the building envelopes are going to be impacted. But there are trees that are outside the building envelopes, and in fact, in some of the rear yard areas and front yard areas, that can be protected and perhaps preserved. Our intent is to create a program for how those trees are to be addressed during construction, both on the site improvements and on the construction of the homes. That would be reflected on the engineering drawings, and it'll also be reflected and discussed every time a permit is issued. Because we're working likely with one builder to do the whole project, that builder should have a clear understanding before the first house is built as to what the protocol will be for protecting significant trees. In creating a site development plan, that site development plan will show not only the location of the house, the driveway, and any impervious surfaces, it'll also indicate the location of the trees, existing grades, and of course, proposed grades. It allows the engineering staff to work to figure out if there might be a way to shift a house, adjust some grading, maybe move a patio or a sidewalk to preserve a tree that they determined to be notable. So my point is that while we may not be able to preserve all of the trees in these areas, we'll at least have a program in place that allows us to save a relatively reasonable amount of those trees. I would add that we will plant a new tree. At least one new tree will be required to be planted in every front yard as the houses are being built. And of course, that tree will be planted after the house is built. And the point I'm making is that over time, this will reclaim itself. By way of example, I did a project in 1985 called Evergreen in Lake Forest. It was a farm field. We were building monstrous houses on it because that was the trend back then. And we had people complaining all the time because of the size of the houses. We planted up the landscaping, and of course, all the houses did their own landscaping. But just the parkway trees alone, if you drive through that subdivision now, even the largest house can't be seen from the street. So it's amazing what landscaping does over time. So it's not about trying to cram as many trees in here as we possibly can as we do this. It's about having a very logical method so that in time, 15 years, and boy, it doesn't take long, you have a much more appropriate result. I talked about the light yellow, and it's the obvious. It's clearly all the places in the subdivision that will be impacted. When we go in, we will clear cut all of those trees, remove them, and as I pointed out earlier, as a result of installing the improvements, doing the backfill, installing parkway trees, putting in the berms around the perimeter, reclaiming some of the areas around the ponds and the areas where the storm sewers are proposed, it will, as I pointed out earlier, reclaim itself. Key features of our plan I've talked about before. Our proposed homes will be architecturally cohesive with quality materials. Landscaping of each home will be designed to blend appropriately and consistently through the development. Each new home will be required to plant at least one native tree, as I pointed out earlier, in the front yard. An oak savanna will be created as open space with native grasses, which is the central area. All open space and common areas will be perpetually maintained by the HOA. And a maintenance plan will be established to protect and reclaim existing woodland areas. There was only one minor issue with the sign, and that was that it was 6 inches too high off the ground. We adjusted it. I guarantee you, if you look at the two that you, the one from last month, you won't be able to tell the difference, but it is now 5 feet off the top, which meets the ordinance. And it, frankly, it doesn't change anything. The architecture, as I pointed out before, the homes will average between 3,200 and 3,800 square feet with 2 and 3 car garages. Most of the houses will have 3 car garages. Proposed homes will be designed in the traditional styles that embrace historically correct vernaculars, including Craftsman, Shingle, New England, European Country. The aesthetic character of the neighborhood will be cohesive and strictly controlled through design covenants. And by the way, one of the comments that was mentioned last month was that we not record the covenants as part of the ordinance. We agree, we're not going to do that. These covenants will include careful assemblage of building mass to provide a coherent and well-balanced facade in each of the 4 elevations of any given home. I know that's been a hot button for the village for over the last few months. Historically correct design elements will be applied. Appropriate use and placement of windows on all 4 elevations. Consistent use of exterior materials with logical termination of masonry materials to avoid the quote-unquote Hollywood facade. And restrict repeating of homes to avoid monotony. These are just a few of the examples of the homes that we propose. This is the one one of the homes they showed last month. This is the same house, same floor plan, different elevations. As I pointed out, we have a Craftsman style, an English country style, a shingle style, and in this case, a colonial style. Same principles applied, different floor plan. Again, Craftsman style, English country. It actually looks like the same house. It's not the same house. Yeah, colonial and shingle style. I took one house, you may recall, and just by way of example to show how we would apply the principles I previously described. This is the front elevation by way of example of the Craftsman style home. This is the right side elevation. This is the left side elevation. You'll see that the alignment of windows, the massing of gables and roof elements are appropriate. And this is the rear elevation. Again, alignment of window masses and roof masses. And this is a typical example of our site plan and how the homes will relate to one another. It's nothing new. I just felt it was important for you to see how the driveways will relate and how much space is provided between the houses. We're asking for a 17-foot, Joe, correct me if I'm wrong, is it 17-foot total side yard setback, 10 and 7, or?
I have to.
We're not asking for a variance in that regard.
That's correct. No variation is being requested on side or front yard.
Mr. Chairman, that's the end of my presentation. I'm prepared to answer any questions you might have for me tonight.
Any questions?
I'll just add an item related to the FAR. This was something that I spoke to Mike Atkinson, our building commissioner, and John Kalmar, the village manager, discussing the FAR and whether or not we would be willing to grant the variations that were presenting here this evening. The reason why staff felt that the variations would be appropriate is due to our belief in wanting to preserve common area open space, primarily the center of the property, as well as the adjacent property areas adjacent to 45 Buffalo Grove Road, as well as the southern property lines. We believe the HOA maintaining that is the best way to make sure that that land is preserved, is kept up with trees and appropriate landscaping or oak savanna. We've seen route encroachments on the right-of-way along 83 and other areas in town where without some sort of buffer separating the property from the right-of-way, inevitably trees will get cut down, properties get extended by just landscaping and plenty of grass. And so rather than have that take place, which inevitably would in the future, we looked at granting a variation and then also requiring fencing along those areas to make sure that there's a clear delineation between the property line and the common area open space.
And a consistent.
Consistent as well. One of the conditions approval outlined specific fence types that would be required as part of that.
I want to add, I'm sorry, I just wanted to add, and I apologize for interrupting you. I wanted to just add that we did read the staff report, and we did see their recommendations. There were a list of, I think, 10 or 15 of them, and we agree with all of them. We talked with staff about them, and we are in agreement, and I just wanted to make that point. So
let me repeat to see if I understood what you said, that the proposed oak savanna would be a fenced area.
It would be a split rail fence would be what would be, there is a maintenance access to the south as well as I think to the northeast of the property that will allow maintenance vehicles and the like to go and make sure that it's being maintained.
And it's also allowing access to the residence, correct?
Correct, I mean, yeah, it would allow access.
How does somebody who doesn't live around that savanna get to it?
The 10-foot separation between 46 and
46. Oh, there it is, okay.
Yeah, I thought there was another one.
45, 46.
And we would delineate that access with a split rail fence.
Is that the only one?
Yes, that's the only access.
It's so you're saying between lots 45 and 46, there's going to be a split rail fencing in there?
Yes, it'll delineate that. Our concern is that typically what happens with homeowners is they claim those areas as their own and lock it so that you can't get through. Candidly and realistically, it's unlikely you're going to have the public going back there. It might be the neighbors on occasion going back there, but it's more likely that maintenance crews will go back there to do controlled burns and so forth. That's why we didn't show a trail running through it.
The reason why it's in here as a 36-inch restriction on height and split rail is because we want to, there's, you know, it's called woodland chase. We want to preserve and maintain the aesthetic of the trees for everyone who's, you know, surrounding the property. And inevitably, some individual may want to have a 6-foot fence and privacy for various reasons, but that's also why we're putting these restrictions in now to make sure that's preserved as.
So realistically, it's just something to be viewed.
Correct.
An area to be viewed.
Right.
And in the narrowest portion of that is what, 120, 130 feet?
I believe that's correct, yes. I know it's at least 100.
And then it's like 400, 500 feet.
Yeah, it's pretty long.
It's going to be utility connections.
Well, you can imagine a house, the amount of houses that are backing up to it, it's fairly, it's fairly large.
But it's not the kind of thing that I think people are going to wander through unless they're going to do some, you know, heavy boot walking through there, but I don't think it's a park.
Mm-hmm. I think we'll have critters running around back in there. That's part of the purpose, is to have a place for wildlife and so forth.
You don't think no other park kids would use that to play?
It's not going to be groomed like that. I think it's going to be more of a rugged.
You don't think the people that live along it are going to do that?
I don't.
I mean,
I think they're going to look at it.
Gross Point mow under the Commonwealth Edison right of way to extend their yards.
Oh, you mean in the back there?
Yeah.
Well, with the fence, they're not going to be able to do that.
They couldn't mow.
Yeah.
Easily.
I don't know. Yeah, oh, I know what you're saying.
Well, it's the reason we put the fence in. We want to make sure that it's very clearly defined, so that, because you're absolutely correct, but at some point in history, that whole area is going to be hijacked by each of the property owners there, if they can. I'll even guarantee that if you don't put the fence up, somebody will wind up putting up one of those play forts into that area.
You showed a paired sites. You showed 2 and 3 together.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And it shows the two driveways into those separated by what I would consider the greatest separation that.
Well, that's correct.
There could be. Where would the driveway be on lot 4?
Well, I mean, the closest the driveway could be is the mirror image of lot 3.
Right.
So if
there's going to be some of that.
Yeah, there's going to be. Let's just put it this way.
Clear for everybody.
But, exactly. And my biggest concern is always to provide at least 4 feet on each side so that there's enough plant area, because that's another issue that you run into with neighbors. Who takes proprietary ownership of landscaping? If it's dead, it's always the other guy. If it's yours, you don't want anybody to touch it. So we try to leave enough room so that there's it keeps peace with neighbors.
So how much do you think is between the side? What is this side?
Side yard minimum is 7 foot.
7 foot. So it's about 7 feet.
Yeah, I would say a little greater than, well, between the driveways, the closest they could possibly be is 14 feet.
Yeah, 14.
Else?
If you don't mind, due to the grading and the topography of the site,
nothing.
One of the things that we've looked at is, and it's in listed in the conditions of approval, of looking at a lot by lot basis, tree preservation, and looking at needing a grading plan related to each individual lot. The thought behind that is, if there are, even though a majority of the trees on each lot will not be able to be saved because of conditions and also construction, we also want there to be an opportunity for the village to take a close look on each lot to see what trees may be able to be saved, especially if there is a high quality tree there. It's one of those things where we I know Mr. Swanson's looking at a landscape plan. I think Chuck Stewart's working on that as we speak. And it's something that will be looked at very closely by the village. And it's something I know that our Public Works Department has a very strong interest in making sure that trees can be preserved wherever possible. One thing that I would just make everyone aware is our tree preservation ordinance, as it stands right now, says that a tree is removed, it needs to be replaced on a 3-to-1 ratio, regardless of whether or not there's a location for those trees to be planted. That's something that the commission might want to review and just understand how that would be stipulated here. One of the reasons why we're looking to have a preservation plan on a lot-by-lot basis is so that we can understand what trees need to be removed. Invasive plants, trees whose drip line enters into a building lot area can all be removed as part of the our development ordinance without any penalty. But at the same time, we also want to recognize that if there's existing trees that look like they will be dying or will be an impediment to the development, that's something that everyone should be aware of. As well as it relates to that, well, I'll stop there. During the conditions of approval, there's a couple notes that I can add related to the trees. In particular, the restriction on type of trees for the parkway trees. Due to the emerald ash borer, in the past it's been Dutch elm, there's been a number of just things that have come up that have unfortunately damaged the health of the trees. So it is important to have a diversity of tree species within the development. Certainly would love to see hardwood trees being planted, but recognizing the fact that we want to make sure these trees can last for years and years and not get swept away in one bad bug, we want to make sure that we give the developer some flexibility as relates to tree type.
What does condition 3 mean, where it says the berm shall be installed with the center point of the property line of less 32 to 22? You tell me the center line of the berm.
That's correct.
So does that mean half of the berm is in the back of lots 32 to 22?
Correct.
Okay, that's not what's drawn here though, right?
It is not. That's something okay. That was made a condition of approval.
Okay, fair enough. If that's the case, with the rear yard setback variance being requested, is it appropriate in lots 23 to 30 or 22 to 32 to have a rear yard setback variance at all if you're going to take it up with berm? That's a question.
And honestly, it was when we looked at having the berm being moved, that wasn't factored in. What we're concerned was is that if at some point Route 45 is widened, we want to make sure that the berm is preserved. And maintained. There is a 50-foot buffer along the majority of Route 45, and so there's very unlikely.
With current or improved?
With improved, with exception of there's one area that may be impacted of about 10 feet, I believe, closer to the intersection of Buffalo Grove Road and Fairway.
So if 45 is improved in any of our lifetimes, what would be the closest with rear yard setback a house could sit to 45?
I think you can see it on sheet number 3, where it shows the proposed right of way.
Yeah. I'm sure I got it. 3.
I don't know where it is on Buffalo Road, but I don't think it matters. I don't think it's germane to your question.
It becomes more of an issue if somebody wants to add an addition on the back. Typically, the houses, when they're built, are going to be built as close to the front yard setback as they can possibly be. The only time that would be an adjustment is if we could preserve a tree by shifting it back a few feet.
Mm-hmm. I guess my concern is on 22 to 32, if the berm is now going to take up some portion of the rear yard, because it's going to be on there. And the rear yard setback, what, is 20 foot now? Is that what it's being asked to be?
Correct.
If I remember right?
Yes.
So with what we're talking about, because what we have is the berm is outside of the rear yards, how far into the rear yards does the berm go?
It doesn't go into the rear yards at all.
Wait.
Not on the plans, it doesn't.
No, but won't it under this condition?
Under the conditions, it would. I mean, we haven't looked at the exact height of the berm and how the grading will be, so I'm not sure we have an exact answer of how much that slope will enter into the rear yard of the property. The intent was really to make sure that the berm would be preserved.
Right. That berm was designed so that it stays within the 50-foot area. And of course, there's an angle of repose, so the wider you go, the higher you can go. Otherwise, you'll have a berm that's like this, and you're not going to have a berm that's like this. So you to have the right angle of repose so that you don't have erosion issues, it can only go so high. I believe that the highest point this will go is 6 or 7 feet.
Okay, but maybe it's late and I'm just slow on the uptake. When you said you agreed to the conditions of approval presented by staff, one condition of approval is the landscape berm along Route 45 shall be installed with the center point of the property line of lots 32 to 22, which then reads to me that the berm will not be only in the 50-foot. It will be with, half of it will be within the rear yards of those 10 or so lots.
That's not going to work. Now I understand your concern.
Okay, that's what I'm not, because with a 20-foot setback, potentially.
Yeah, you don't have any backyard.
Right, that's right. So that's why I don't understand how this is going to work.
Well, I was reading that as the center of the line of the fence. Let me point out that all of the takings that we are aware of with the state have been taken. We've taken all of that into consideration in our design. What Joe is referring to is in the future, if there's any kind of an expansion that they eat into it.
Fair enough.
What I found with berms, though, since we're airing this all out, if the berm stays where I have it designed currently, if in fact that were to happen, what happens with any berm, they basically cut into it and they put a landscape wall in front of it so that it still maintains that angle of repose, but it gets cut off. So that's the way it would be addressed, and that's if they decide to take it at a later date. And who knows what's going to happen 20 years from now.
So let's then go back to, do you have the conditions for approval?
Actually, I do not. I had a problem with my printer before I came over.
I can make a copy.
Well, can we just show it? Let us just show you what it says. If someone's got one that's not written on.
Number 3 at the bottom.
Look at condition 3 on page 4.
Yeah, that's okay. That obviously that's not going to work. I don't think it's necessary, and if it were, the easy answer would be if the state needed more land, because as I pointed out, we've already taken into consideration their improvements.
Mm-hmm.
So, and by the way, that could be true of any of our properties, you know, the state or the county or anybody can come along.
Okay.
So all we can do is we can do so much. You can argue that they need and by the way, if they do it to us, they're going to have to do it to the cemetery, and I'm doubtful that that's going to happen. So, however, let's assume that it does. We're going to have a well-established berm there. And the worst condition would be that the state now has to put in some kind of a retaining wall.
Okay, but for purposes of what we're considering, this condition of approval number 3, you don't believe from a developer standpoint is workable because of the impact it'll have on the rear yards of lots 22 to 32. Is that a fair statement?
That's a fair statement, yes. Not so much on the corner lots, but certainly on the lots that are not on that radius.
Well, you got it running down to the last one in Buffalo Grove Road.
I assume I'll leave it out.
Oh, fair enough. Okay. So from a staff/village perspective, I understand the intention here. Is this a condition that, I don't even know how to phrase it, that, you know, you're set on, a must, has to be?
I don't believe it is. The intent truly was to make sure that the berm would be maintained in the event that Route 45 is widened.
You say widened, you mean beyond the current lane?
Correct.
Beyond the currently contemplated improvements.
Oh, or including the contemplated improvements.
Including.
Wait, that.
So right now, I mean, there it's.
He's the it's petitioner's four saying he's designed this to accommodate a four-lane Route 45.
Well, it's existingly. It's. Oh no, I see. It's yeah. Yeah. No, it'd be four lanes.
It's two with turn lanes.
Sorry, I was thinking, yeah. You're right.
So it's currently designed to accommodate a four-lane road like what goes through Lincolnshire?
parts of it are. I don't think they've, IDOT's acquired all the right-of-way. I don't even know if they've all the plan, I don't have a copy of the plans of what they plan to do. I know that's something that.
They did provide a copy of that plan.
Oh, they did?
And you're correct. We don't know when it's going to happen, but we do know that we've accommodated that design into our design. And I believe that's your question.
Correct.
Right.
But as it relates to whether or not that item wants to be taken off of condition approval, that's certainly something we can do. The intent, again, was just to make sure that the berm wasn't impacted by any construction or construction easement that IDOT may be requesting.
And in all fairness, I have to fall on my sword on this one because Joe did take the time to walk through each of these with me, and I actually read it out loud, and I still didn't pick up on it. I was imagining something completely different. So as much as I'd like to blame staff, but I can't. That's right.
Is it four lanes, sir, or with turn lanes? Is it six?
Well, I don't know exactly how they plan on widening it, to be honest.
However many lanes it is. It accommodates the proposed expansion improvement plans for 45, the one that you've done.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Actually, I believe that was asked last month. I remember the engineer, or my engineer, standing up and saying, yes, we did take into consideration that design.
Okay.
So you want to say, I think this is where you're thinking, Jim, is the landscape berm along Route 45 shall be maintained throughout all future road improvements on Route 45. Is that what you're thinking?
The currently anticipated, yeah. I don't know that you could say 30 years down the road might want something else.
But we're hearing
But as the petitioner has said, you know, at that point in time, it's really the burden is on
the state.
The burden's on that.
It really is.
Sure.
Right.
Sure.
Yeah.
I mean, because all you can do is anticipate what you can contemplate and what has been proposed and discussed and researched.
Mm-hmm.
So is that good language mm-hmm. for you? The landscape berm along Route 45 shall be maintained throughout all future road improvements on Route 45.
Well, that's the developer can't. The developer can't sign that because you're not going to be here after you develop. I think it has to be installed, consistent with the currently known or something.
Okay, so
isn't it got to be? It's got to be more like that, I believe.
And it'll be maintained by the HOA once we turn it over to them. So over time, whether it's 2 years from now or 10 years from now, it's going to be maintained
right.
by them.
Yeah.
I would recommend maybe it shall be installed consistent with the proposed Route 45.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. And that does provide us room for error in terms of if they are adding a deceleration lane or something. Then
right. Okay. Can you just remind me, because once again, you know, in my advanced age, I forget these things. Condition number 12 talks about the high school and elementary school district boundary lines. What districts are you actually in?
I can answer that if you like.
Go ahead.
It's Vernon Hills High School, Stevenson High School, Lincolnshire Prairie View School District, which is what's one.
Right. Right.
And then it's the Hawthorne 73. The 73, 103, 128, and 125.
And that line is right here.
Oh.
Right here. So everything north of that is Vernon Hills High School and Hawthorne, and everything south of that is Stevenson and Lincolnshire Prairie School.
Okay.
It's not the first time.
I'm a former school board president. Trust me, I know.
Does Centennial Crossing maintain their own detention areas? Is that village responsibility?
No, it would be the HOA's responsibility.
So it's not unusual for the HOA to be responsible for the detention?
Correct. Georgetown development is also another example where detention is being maintained by the HOA. And the County Executive Park, the Van Vlissingen properties are all maintained through a centralized.
Well, that's a business park.
Correct. And just as an example,
Has the village ever had any issues in that regard? With them not being...
Other than they don't want to?
Yeah, I mean, right now, I mean, we're fortunate that we're still a newer community where we haven't had issues. I know Village maintained detentions. We're starting to see some culvert replacements in certain areas of town. But as it relates to private, I'm not aware of any that exist.
Sorry, Lisa. Continuing on with that question about the berm, and number four talks about a fence that's installed on top of the berm. I mean, that doesn't make sense anymore either, does it?
Well, I think it does, because we still want to provide screening of the roadway from the rear yards, as well as this also addresses the commission's concerns about headlight sweeping onto the property.
It does, but then what it creates is it creates the ability of those lots, or it encourages those lots to co-opt that space for their own. If the fence is outside their lot line.
To a degree, and we were just talking about the center line of that berm, okay? The center line of that berm is not on the rear property line, right?
Anymore.
Not anymore.
Okay, so now the 6-foot fence, double-sided fence, is on top of the berm that's no longer on the property line.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So is this a straight fence, or is this a serpentine fence? Because that's not a straight, I mean, berms are not, I mean.
No, but it serpentine horizontally, no. Serpentine vertically, yes. I think you're going to follow the shape of the berm as it rolls through.
Okay.
So in other words, you're looking in plan view, it's straight.
It's straight.
It's right on that, well, in this case, on the center of the berm.
Because the center of the berm isn't really, is it straight? It's going to be.
But I do get the point, though, because if you do put a fence in your side yard, that fence is going to terminate somewhere. Is it going to terminate 25 feet from where the fence is now, or is it going to terminate up the side of the berm and into the fence? So, and I think the answer is, if you're going to have a yard and you're going to do that, perhaps the easy answer is to punt. I think the easy answer is that if you're going to have, you need it for privacy purposes, as I sort of air this out, I think that the fence should be on their lot line, not up to that berm. And the berm is really there for screening. On the other hand, you could argue, who really cares?
Wait, I mean, you're suggesting put the six-foot privacy fence on the lot line? Is that what it is? Yeah.
Right. There's a 6-foot privacy fence that's going to be on the center of the berm.
But that's not really,
it doesn't
well,
do anything.
It,
it's not doing
it,
what
it defines your lot versus
it
the
defines
way
the lot,
some,
but it doesn't do anything with
capture
the headlight.
Space in between their because lot the, and the fence.
You gotta,
I'm not giving up the fence on the berm. The fence stays
oh, you
on
want
the berm.
Both.
Both, yeah.
Oh.
If you have a pool in your backyard,
I
you're going to have to by
I'm
law.
Sorry.
So the question is one of two things. We can either take the new fence that they put in the side yard and run it all the way back, all the way up, and they basically technically get an extra 25 feet that they control. Now, on one hand, who really cares? Because you're never going to see the backside of that berm unless you live back there anyways. Uh-huh. So it's really the other side of the berm that matters. So from my perspective, from a practical standpoint, it would just seem to me to allow that fence to terminate into the upper fence. The problem I have with it is, how's that going to look? If it rolls up the side of the berm, it'll look a little strange in my mind. So I think what we have to do, because I don't know that we're going to solve this problem tonight, is to work that out with staff and have that as a condition. We just need to kind of, I know there's an answer, we just have to come up with the most appropriate one.
What style of fence were you, for individual home lots were you envisioning?
Well, we're limiting it to the aluminum wrought iron, faux wrought iron look, or to certain cedar fences, as long as they have a matching face on both sides. And the reason for that is somebody always gets the side they don't want. And we want to have at least a reasonable level of consistency. If I had my way, I'd have it so that all the fences are the aluminum wrought iron faux look, because it forces, if you want privacy, it forces you to plant landscaping in order to get that privacy. And of course, the fence serves another purpose. It keeps coyotes out, and it keeps kids from getting into pools and everything else. So But for now, the language we've created is a limitation on the kinds of fences that you can do. To Joe's point earlier, by way of example, we're defining the conservancy areas with a split rail fence because it is open space and you want to be able to see it. And we want to make sure there's a consistency of fencing in those areas. That doesn't prohibit folks from living in there, who will live in there, from using that same kind of fence. But in some cases, people want privacy. So the easy answer might be, well, I mean, clearly what we're doing with the fence that's on the berm is to create this element to it's actually providing a utilitarian purpose. And that's to keep the noise and the reduce the amount of noise from Route 45 and Buffalo Grove Road, and of course to provide privacy and protection from light pollution and so forth. So I need to think about this, to tell you the truth, Jeff. I know there's an answer. On one hand, do we put the fence on the lot line and still keep the fence on the center of the berm? Or do we just let the fence run right up the side of the berm or right into the berm and let that homeowner take proprietary use of that berm? Candidly, they're the only ones that are ever going to see it anyways. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not like we're blocking off open space for the community.
It's similar to what some of the homeowners along Butterfield have done in Greg's Landing, is that there's that wrought iron fence up on the berm. And a lot of them have landscaped up to that fence, even though it's not on their property. They've kind of assumed the role there.
Right. I think that's the most practical solution, because it seems a little awkward to have two fences mm-hmm. and then have this area that nobody's going to go back and use anyways. You're sort of creating an unintended, there's an unintended consequence, is my point.
Mm-hmm. And it's logical.
The question I have is, did I read that the fences are only going to be like 36 inches yeah. or 4 feet tall? 3 feet or 4 feet?
No, you're allowed up to a 6 foot fence. I think
up to a 6 foot?
Yeah. The fence that we're talking about as the split rail fence would be 42 inches tall, I think it would be the highest it can be. You have to meet certain codes. If you have a pool in the backyard, you have to have a minimum, I believe it's 36 inches actually for a pool. Might even be 42 inches.
Is it?
Some communities it's six feet.
I thought
it was higher than 3 feet. So those fences that we were just talking about, that Jeff was inquiring about, those are the 42 inches or 36 inches.
That's correct. The ones that are split rail.
Well, condition of approval one is fencing is maximum height of 36 inches along side and rear property lines.
And that would have to be different if someone did put in a pool.
Yeah, that is an issue. It's one we need to address.
I think it's 4 feet at least.
I'm not sure what it is.
I don't know what it is.
That or we restrict pools. I mean, right now it's saying above ground pools are not allowed.
But in ground.
Yeah.
What's it? Pools aren't allowed, did you say?
That's an option.
I don't think that's going to work.
Well, above ground aren't allowed.
And the design guidelines, it says above ground pools are not allowed. So you're thinking about
I didn't hear the above ground part. Yo, I thought you said pools. No, that's true. Above ground pools will not be allowed. They have to be in ground pools. That's correct. But the state has a requirement on fencing around that pool. And I'm pretty sure it's no less than 36 inches. Well, but I think it's actually higher.
Insurance driven.
Right. I know the village does have a height for private pools. But public pools, it's even higher. So it should be rewarded to be what, if there is a pool, to be the correct height.
Yeah.
And can you, I know some communities you can't do, if you have a pool, it has to be solid. You can't do split rail. I mean, I don't know what ours is. I don't have a pool, so I've never looked.
No, I am sure you're correct in terms of the liability and risk insurance issue.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
I think for split rail, let's just back into what the code requires for height, minimum height for the pool, and for the wood fence and the wrought iron fence, I think a maximum height is 6 feet. That's what I'm used to in just about every community, unless the community, the village has an ordinance against higher fences. I'm not aware of it, but.
I think that, I mean, from staff perspective, I understand the liability risks of where we, I mean, legally, we can't restrict or place a maximum height next to a pool. Otherwise, though, a six-foot fence kind of takes away from the aesthetics of the forested area and the surrounding properties.
I think we agree. I think that's true. That's why I said on the split rail fence. You've got 36. I'm fine with 36 inches on the split rail fence, unless code requires it to be higher. I mean, for safety purposes.
And that certainly could be adjusted on here, as to say, unless state and local ordinances dictate otherwise. I mean, I think that's implied, because there's, we wouldn't enforce that.
But see, the problem is, if there's an HOA, you can independently, privately contract for anything. And even if that says you can't do something, that's the law of tough. So if this gets created this way with an HOA, that may be it. You know, so by definition, we may be saying you can't do certain things as the unintended consequence.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Another question here about the conditions, and I lost. Oh, it's condition 7. Because there's only sidewalks on one side of the two streets, so the traditional definition of a parkway, I understand there. What are parkway trees otherwise, if there is not a parkway on all those other lots?
It's typically the space, it's the sidewalk is on the inside, right, of the ROW. So that would be the curb, between the curb and the sidewalk would be the parkway, and in this instance of the sidewalk, one could define the parkway as the same distance on the other side. And that's still part of the ROW. It's still part of the right-of-way.
It is. And that, I guess, is the interpretation that we have had, is that it's within the right-of-way.
So for purposes, I should look to this. For purposes of right-of-way, it's running to just inside the sidewalk on the outer homes and then someplace in the front yards of the...
It's outside the sidewalk, depending on how you...
Between the sidewalk and the street, although they're not showing on there, Hal.
They're not showing it, right.
Yeah, they're not showing on there.
Sidewalk is public property, so it would be inside the right-of-way.
What confused
right.
me as
yeah.
well.
Yeah.
Right. It does say it in the condition,
right,
but it doesn't show it
mm-hmm.
in that landscape plan.
Right. Right, because they're all on the other side.
So therefore, the clarification of your question is right on.
Okay. So are you So when you talk about planting a tree on each lot after construction is completed, mm-hmm. are you talking
yes.
about a parkway tree or a tree on the actual lot that's going to be owned in fee simple by the owner?
No, it'll be on the actual lot within their building envelope or their property. I should say not within their building envelope, inside their property.
Inside their property line.
Correct.
And building envelope would be kind of hard. Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. And we require parkway trees per?
One per, it is, I believe it's.
So many feet or something?
Like 40 feet, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
These lots are all 40 feet, I assume, wide, at least.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody's going to start with a parkway tree of some sort, kind of near the street. And then
that's
some
correct.
Sort of other tree.
Then they're required to put one other in the
other,
front yard.
In the front yard.
I believe it has to be a heritage tree.
The front yard tree.
One of four types.
Right,
yep.
right,
right,
right.
Public Works mentioned that as it relates to this item, revising the parkway tree plantings to say shall be planted per village ordinance, so there's more flexibility and diversity of tree species.
So it's not going to be limited to oak, elm, hickory, or walnut?
That was a recommendation of the Public Works Department. So that, you know,
mm-hmm.
I know there's resistant trees for, certain elm trees now are resistant to Dutch elm that are able to be planted and preserved, but if something else comes up, the thought is we're asking for trouble if all of a sudden we're losing a bunch of, you know, maples and we've then wiped
okay.
out.
So for parkway, you want to have it just be more general, but what about for condition 10, which is, for the design guidelines, a minimum of, it says one oak, maple, or walnut shall be planted in the front yard. That staff's okay with leaving?
Yes.
That way?
Yeah,
okay.
Absolutely.
Fair enough.
Okay. And I know, I mean, one of the comments Dave has made is related to this is, okay, you know, should it be one or should it be two? And then also, what happens if there's a quality tree in the front yard? What do you do then? And then that's where the thought was, well, then it will be planted in the rear lot, and then that'll be, and that was the way that was discussed, because that could be an option that could come up admit it's unlikely, to be honest, because of just the quality trees and between the grading and construction, it'll be difficult. But at the same time, we want to make sure there's options to make sure that they do get one or two trees, which two trees in the front yard of higher quality hardwood tree could be a nice aesthetic.
Anybody else?
Yeah, on the architecture, you know, I like the proportion, the scale, the quality of the materials, and carrying the four-sided architecture around. You have the two base plans and the four elevations each as a starting point. This is a question for you, sorry. So with the architecture, you know, he's proposing two base plans, but elevations. But as things evolve with the different lot sizes and the different FARs, every house is going to be a little unique. You know, correct. Some people are going to add on, some people will have less. So these aren't the actual final elevations that we're seeing. It's more of a concept. So how do you, you know, it's written in the, for the approval as final approval of the architectural elevations, but it's not really, it's just more of a concept.
It is approval of a concept. I talked with Joe earlier today about this, and I know it's a very important part of this approval process. It's just as important to me. We are in the process of selecting who our builder is going to be, and both builders have expressed a willingness to work with us on the architectural side of things. So what I suggested is that a condition of approval, because both builders have said we won't close on the property unless we have approval of the architecture. Well, that's a good thing, because we have the ability to come back, and as I talked to Joe about this today, it could be as simple as just allowing staff to review it, and if it passes the smell test, doesn't have to come back to anybody. But if it needs further review, or for that matter, if this board and the village board decides that it's appropriate for us to come back and get that approved by them, well, we're happy to do that. It wouldn't be my first rodeo when it comes to an architectural review process. So I guess my point is, at some point, we're going to come to you with what that product is. It could very well be this product if they elect to use this. I'm more than happy to allow them to use it. But the point of this was to show a genuine effort to take a more aesthetically conscious approach to this. So they recognize it. We will work with them. And the burden will be on us to make sure that the village is satisfied with the end result.
So in the past, what's happened is, I mean, especially with Greg's Landing as a good example, the new construction that's going on is all essentially being managed by the HOA. Similar to Stone Fence Farms with the 80 Brookhill property, the HOA already had certain design guidelines in place that then were met and followed. With the village, as it stands right now, because an HOA hasn't been established, they're essentially going to be ruled by the design features that have been proposed in Rick's plans, as well as the masonry ordinance, which was passed by the village board, which requires all brick or stone or masonry materials. Now, that variation is something that, by the ordinance, requires further review by the village board. Now, what we have discussed internally at the staff level is essentially looking at it with our building commissioner reviewing the plans, seeing it matches in terms of consistency of proportional stone, brick, or masonry materials, and on all four sides, to ensure that the plans that are presented here are consistent in that type, so that there's not anything goofy as it relates to just all of a sudden you got a turret on a otherwise New England style home, or, you know, some other weird kind of Frankenstein type home. And because of the fact that these lots are going to be purchased on a lot by lot basis, you know, there's no telling if a homeowner decides they want to purchase two lots and just construct one home on a lot. I mean, there's no guarantee that all the lots would be developed if someone decided that. I mean, certain properties have walkout conditions. If the homeowner decides, you know, depending on what kind of model home they want, that may impact what they decide to do with grading, and that's, or landscaping, which again is why we want to look at it on a lot-by-lot basis, so that we can make sure that trees or driveways, other design aesthetics as it relates to the home itself, can all be looked at under a really close lens to make sure those details can get fleshed out.
I think, though, I made it clear in the last meeting that we're not going to be selling off lots to individual property owners. This is going to be a builder. We're going to design the homes. There's going to be an array of designs to choose from. They won't repeat the same house. At least there won't be a monotony. We will meet the monotony code as we agreed we would. I'm more fearful of a subdivision where you put in the improvements and you just sell off all the lots to different builders and you wind up getting kind of a mutt of houses in there. Some are good, some of them are not so good, and it's only as good as the people reviewing and controlling that design review. In this case, what we're doing is, and what I'm suggesting to you is that we would come back if deem it appropriate, or we can work directly with staff to bring in the houses that we're proposing. And I'm sure staff would be more than happy to share that information with, I know it's a particular importance to you, Jeff, because you're an architect. It would be to me if I were on the Plan Commission. But we're my point is we're more than happy to be proactive in that regard. And as I told Joe this morning, I'm going to be tougher than I think the village will be in that regard. Because, it's my reputation. It's my name that is applied to this. So I can tell you that, and I can also speak for Jim Martin. It's very important to him as well that this result is good because he's well-regarded in the community. He lives here. So this is something that's meaningful to both of us. So in that regard, I don't want to stand here today and tell you, these are the houses we're going to look the other way. We're not going to do that. On the other hand, if we do use these, I think these houses pass the smell test. I'm getting the impression that you're comfortable with these. It's a matter of, making sure that the other houses that come in do the same. And we know that burden's on us to prove.
Back to your comment about purchasing two lots.
Or more.
You're not planning on doing that, allowing that.
We're not selling lots off to individual property owners. You're not going to be able to walk in and say, I want to buy that lot.
You can't buy two lots and build a house on both of those lots.
I suppose you could do that, yes.
One house on both lots.
You could. It's been done, but I doubt that's going to happen.
What if we want the super house, the 8,000 square foot house? Because you're adding up the two FARs that you've allowed for both of those lots. And now all of a sudden we have the monster home that sits in the middle of the property. I don't know. Is that going to be allowed or is it?
Well, that's going on. That's going on over at Greg's Landing.
I understand that.
Well, that would happen at Greg's Landing because you have those are custom lots with custom individual builders. This is going to be bought by one builder. He's going to control the entire development. That's the difference. But that's not to say that somebody who isn't going to walk in and say, "I want your Model C." Blow some air into it and make it double the size, that could be problematic because it'd be out of character with the neighborhood. I suppose we could write some language in the covenants that would prohibit that because it's unlikely that that's going to happen, but this is a good time to have that conversation. Could be as simple as just saying, if you buy a house or buy two lots or buy a lot and a half, you can only build one house on it and you're only allowed so much FAR. Maybe you're allowed some relief, 10% relief on the FAR, but that's it. I don't want to make it more complicated than it needs to be, but a lot of what ifs out there.
Well, it's one of the conditions of approval. Certainly can be added that, in terms of maximum allowed building footprint. I think there's maximum allowed at this point, I believe, in terms of FAR. I mean, just stipulate that there could be a restriction.
I think the way you start is the number of lots is what is being proposed at this time. I mean, that's where you start. You say that this is the site plan that we are approving.
They would, now I'm thinking more of this, they would essentially have to come back and amend the PUD to allow basically
a double-sized lot.
Which I would say right now, I mean, based off of the tenor of the room, would not be accepted at the Planning Zoning Commission level. But it would certainly be a long process, even if it was being something contemplated, to the point where it would likely be something that whoever was interested in that would probably move on before they got through the review process.
The brain damage factor.
Good way to start.
Yeah, yeah.
The FAR matrix, where did the 47% number come from?
That was based off of looking at what was being the variance ratio and just taking, that was essentially what was the highest ratio that was being proposed in his plans. And we were reviewing the lots as it related to the site, and that was how essentially that was determined.
It was more.
It really was just taking it from what was being proposed by Swanson and putting it into the report as being acceptable.
Okay, so the normal variant without a variance would be 33%.
Correct.
So we're going up 14%.
Correct.
And just doing some perusing here, there's only five houses that. I mean, you're requested FAR maximum on square footage. There's only five that are listed under 4,000 square feet. So I, you know, if I'm the developer, I'm certainly going to be trying to sell the biggest homes possible, I would think.
Mm-hmm.
More money, right?
Yep.
I could tell you that would be the logical conclusion, but the reality is, I talked to a lot of builders, and I talked to the two that we've narrowed it down to. The biggest house that they, both of them offer, and that's if somebody adds on all the bells and whistles, in one case it's 4,100, and the other one it's 4,000. And they told me that about 20% of the houses they sell will exceed 3,600 square feet. The rest of them are going to be in the neighborhood of 3,400 to 3,500 square feet. They do sell bigger houses, but it's usually taking an existing house and adding attic space, finishing off attic space, or adding out a porch on the back or something along that line.
Why is that the sweet spot, 34, 36? Why?
I think it's really, honestly, I think it's, look, I grew up in a house that was 1,800 square feet, so to me that sounds like a lot. But, you know, the that has all of the amenities that I think buyers are looking for. You know, they don't want living rooms anymore. They want great rooms, kitchens, and breakfast rooms that are open to one another. If they want to expand space and bigger space, they finish off the lower level. They put in a deeper basement. We're seeing a lot of that with windows actually real windows built into the concrete walls and basements. Master bedroom and three bedrooms, a Jack and Jill between two and a bathroom off of another. I mean, you know, the needs are not, we're not drawing houses anymore that are 6,000-7,000 square feet. Yeah, we're getting them, but they're just not as common. People are becoming more practical about their needs. And 3,500 to 3,600 square feet just happens to be the sweet spot for families. I mean, my house is 3,500 square feet, and I'm swimming in it. Just my wife and I, but we're swimming in it.
Anybody else?
That one's 3,480. And the other one, I believe, is around 30, I think it's a little bit slightly bigger, 3,540, somewhere in there. But they're in that range. But that house you see is about the size that you're going to see in this development. And by the way, if they get bigger, it's not because of the mass and scale of the house. It's not like it's going to stretch wider because there's only so much room you can have. And we're not asking for a variance on the side yard. It usually happens going back. They'll blow out they'll offer an option for example, for a great room, they might say, well, gee, I want to make it another 4 feet deeper. It's the same wall, it just gets pushed back farther.
So the FAR, is that figured in walkout basements only, or is that figured in, do basements figure in that at all?
Basements do not.
No. Basements do not walk out basements?
It's the way The way, I talked to Mike Atkinson about this today, just to verify, porches, basements, and garages all are not factored into the FAR.
I know what you're asking, because in many cases, they are counted if they're a walkout or an English basement. So I understand what you're saying. The difference here is that all of the houses that would have that back up to open space or are controlled by a berm, and that's if they push it to the limit. The ordinance is what the ordinance is, and, you know, yes, we're absolutely going to have lots that do have the ability to have English basements and walkouts. I mean, there isn't anybody in this room that would take advantage of the slope of their lot to have, sure, that additional space.
Sure, but I'm just wondering if that's figured in, typically figured into FAR.
I believe the answer is that it's not, because it's still considered basement.
Still considered a basement.
Right. I mean, the reality is, there are not a lot of whole lot of properties in the Midwest, particularly in Vernon Hills, that allow you a walkout or an English basement.
Well, the contour of our land isn't that way.
That's right. We're flatlanders. We like it that way.
No, we live in Vernon Hills.
Very, very small.
Okay, one more question on the FAR. In your beginning presentation, you talked about, I think it was basically homes 23 through 32, and you mentioned that they would be smaller homes because of, I guess, you know, so that they wouldn't get the traffic light and whatever, noise and sound, but yet you've asked for six of them, you've asked for the largest FARs. So there is a possibility large homes could be there.
That's right, and what I'm trying to, it's impossible for me to market property that doesn't allow some level of ceiling. So it really comes down to isolating those lots that might have the most impact from a visual standpoint. We did reduce those, but we needed to provide a ceiling for it because, I mean, you know, if you're selling houses, you want people to walk in. You don't want to lose a sale on a certain lot because you've already sold a lot that you could put a 4,200 square foot house on to somebody who's building a 2,400 square foot house. So we're trying to follow what natural patterns are in terms of what the consumer is buying. And as I said, the consumer is buying houses that are in the 34. In fact, 4,200 square feet is really pushing the envelope for a house, I think, in Vernon Hills. It's not true in Greg's Landing, but it's certainly, I think most of the houses in Vernon Hills you would argue on the higher side are in the 3,200 to 3,800 square foot range.
All right, now I just want to talk about 19, 20, 21, and 22 for a minute. Is that really a berm behind those to the south, or is it a swale?
No, it's a berm.
It's a berm.
There's a swale in front of it that picks up, there'll be an inlet there that'll pick up the water.
Picks up the water to distribute
it to the
west.
And then it flows to the west, that's correct.
Okay. So that seems to be, I mean, those four houses are close to the residence that's next door. They're pretty close to that one. And that was the question about how tall those houses are. Okay, so we talked about that. First of all, I don't know what the point of the berm is really, other than to help hold the water on the site, because the berm really, I don't know what it doesn't seem to really be doing much, other than maybe it's a way for trees to, and I'm going to make a point right now. You said it, and you said it exactly right. There should be room in between these landscape elements, these trees, so that they are allowed to mature, so they are allowed to do their job when they're 10, 15, 20 years old.
Mm-hmm.
But until they get to that point, it's a toothless, you know, it's a gap. It's a gap in between the landscaping in that back there. But that, I don't think that there's anything we're going to be able to say that, or do, anybody could do, that would have those houses not be imposing upon, you know, a big presence on the neighboring property, because they're going to be pretty tall. They start taller. They're higher in the overall contour.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think there's anything that can be done there. But it is an issue. And I know it was an issue for the neighboring property.
Well, I could tell you that I always have this conversation when we do developments. People plant berms and and the comment that inevitably is always made at some point in the process, and it's usually someone who's on the board, said, well, you know, those trees would be planted, but that's only, you know, what's that going to do over the next 4 or 5 years? Well, my experience is that they grow pretty fast. It does fill up pretty fast. We're already providing a substantial greenway space there as it is. We're not putting our lot line right up against the adjacent property line.
It's like 25 feet.
No, I think it's more than that. That was 35 feet, but it's more than anybody else has given us. So I guess my point is that we're happy to put the berm there. We're happy to plant it. We will plant it. We're not going to put little tiny seedlings in there. We will work with the adjacent property. I'm not going to tell you we're going to go and plant 40-foot trees there,
no.
But well, I think reasonable nursery stock that will grow quickly. My experience with landscape berms is that the age-old saying in landscaping is first year creep, third year leap. And I would say after 4 or 5 years, you're going to see a significant change in that berm if we plant it correctly. But I do agree with your point. It's not that I want to cheat the amount of plantings. I just want to make sure that those who really know what they're doing are telling me, yes, if you plant this tree, it's going to have, I mean, I planted trees on a house I owned in Door County. I planted 6-foot trees, and seven years later, they're actually I planted them 10 feet away from my driveway. They're encroaching into my driveway now. I have to trim them back because they're encroaching into the driveway. They grow pretty fast. So
I guess the point is I wanted it mentioned again that these houses, they're going to be tall along that property line. You know, it's going to be, and that house next door is tucked fairly, it's oriented more north on that lot, closer to that lot line. And that those four houses there are going to be seen as being fairly close to that house. I don't think there's any getting around it.
And honestly, I think that's why, at least at the staff level, I mean, the comments were expressed by the adjacent property owner involving that, and specifically, you know, the walkout conditions due to the grade. And that's exactly why the berm was proposed with landscaping to mitigate to an extent possible. Not saying that will solve everything, because elevations are what they are, but to at least mitigate to that to some degree, and at the very least create some sort of physical separation between the two, because you're right, the home, you know, the house is configured where primarily it's the close to the lot line.
Yeah,
there's nothing we can do about it.
The only way to resolve it would be to eliminate those four lots, and I don't think that is really something that's doable. That's the only way.
Okay. This is a continued public hearing. So even though we closed the public comment last time, because now we have something different. If anyone from the public wants to speak on this, this is the time to do so.
Good evening. Andy Brinkerhoff, Jason property owner, and my brother Pete Brinkerhoff, we were here last time as well, mm-hmm. Jason property owner. We appreciate the progress made, and we've had some good meeting with Pearson Brown and village staff to kind of go through our different concerns, and you folks just kind of wrapped up on one of the topics that still remains very much of concern to us, and that's the height of these buildings in proximity to our existing home. But in terms of the proposed berm and the landscape treatment on those lots 19 through 22, we think that will give us, you know, some natural separation, privacy, screening, et cetera, especially with the contemplated, you know, walkout scenario. Mr. Swanson didn't show in these elevations the walkout in the rear, but it is quite an imposing structure. Maybe Pete, you could just talk about that a little bit.
If you take, as you all know, the roof is a story in height. Then you have two stories below that, first and second floor. And then the walkout, which is not part of the FAR, could be as big as the builder, owner wants to make it. That's a four-story structure that is within, 25 feet of the property line. And so one mitigation would be to eliminate walkouts for those particular lots. So that's one less story.
But how does the walkout, in your mind affect the elevation of the house? Because unless you're stepping into that first floor of that house, that walkout really has no bearing on what you're talking about.
No, but you're looking up at it because the elevation of my brother's property, you're looking up at it and you're going to see that walkout, you know.
Will you see the walkout?
Pardon?
Will you see the walkout? You'll see the berm,
yes,
but you will not
from see, your you will not first see the walk- and second floor.
Oh, from yes. second floor. From yeah. your second floor.
Yeah, you look out your second floor window, you see a four-story mass. Immediately, very close. And so to eliminate a story off of that and not have walkouts for those particular lots reduces the height and the visual mass impact.
Is it the visual impact you're concerned about or the height?
It's the visual impact.
Because the height, there is going to be, correct me if I'm wrong, Joe, there's a maximum height.
From the front yard.
35 feet. Yeah.
From the front yard.
No, I understand.
It slopes.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why it's creating a potential walkout scenario.
But the walkout, what does it add? Another 10 feet.
Feet. People want to finish, it's 10 feet to the first floor with a 9-foot ceiling for most basements.
But that's really only visually accessible from the second floor of that resident, not from the first floor. Because you're looking up
right.
a little bit. You're looking up, right. And then there's a berm. So you're not going to see that walkout from the first floor or at
grade. The view is both ways from their second floor looking down. Into.
So you'll have to not look at each other.
That would be perfect.
Right. And Mr. Swanson, with all due respect, he characterized the overlap as our garage, but in fact, half of a lot is on the garage side, and maybe two lots are overlapping the house. So there's a fair amount of our house exposed. And, we did rebuild that house after the fire, but that was a cumulative process. We rebuilt because of insurance requirements on the same foundation perimeter that was there all along. So, it would have been the chance to move the house, but because of the insurance and trying to reconstruct and repair, that's why it went back exactly where it was.
Which is 50 years old.
Yeah, we've been there for 48 years. The other issue, just to kind of tick through them, that we've made good progress on is continuing our concern about just making a separation between our property and the adjacent and that area between lots 18 and 19, because that opens up into our yard, a big open space there. If we could get some consideration to create some manner of additional buffer there, maybe a split rail fence or whatever, just to make sure that the kids from the neighborhood aren't wandering down into the open yard. The other issue that we discussed quite a bit with Dave Brown and Pearson and Mr. Swanson's folks from Pearson Brown was the detention pond. And Joe, I gave you the overviews that Gaywald Hamilton did. And on there you can see the natural flow of the water from that detention pond area comes in an easterly direction over towards our and across our property. And one of the suggestions, as we now realize that we can't do anything to excavate or berm up or otherwise to control the water flow, is to create a so-called rain garden that would act as kind of a soft planted buffering so that it would absorb the water, slow it down from migrating east towards us on our property. And we agree that, I did hear Mr. Swanson say tonight that he's talking about putting a walkway around those detention ponds, so I just kind of wonder that additional hard surface there, does that interfere with that rain garden structure that's being discussed? Those are the big issues to kind of think through, and that we would still have ongoing concerns about and are appreciative of the consideration so far.
Could you tell me just one thing? Tell me how the water goes, how does the water currently encroach on your property down that southwesterly corner?
Well, it naturally flows following the contours. For example, in the areas around those detention ponds, I believe it's the elevation of 664 and 665. And as you come across in the big shallow pan and the midsection and going towards the eastern portion of my property towards Buffalo Grove Road, the elevation to 661. So as it comes, it's going to seek its own, the lowest level. And that's why it's flowing easterly. It does follow somewhat along that willow tree stand that we have there.
The other thing Andy brought up last time is that IDOT promised that there would be no more water on their property as a result of the work that they were doing. In fact, that has not proven to be the case.
It used to be a scenario, as I mentioned the last time, we'd have water, sitting water pooling up there for several weeks a year. Now we've got pooling water for 10 months out of the year. And for the first time this week, because of probing on this water, the detention pond, et cetera, somebody gave me a good explanation as to why that's happening. When they put in those shoulders for the bridge, they eliminated the possibility of creating like a dugout structure so that the water would flow straight south towards the creek. So in fact, those shoulders from the bridge kick the water that comes out of the flared end section from the sewer lines from the intersection into my yard, which is why I got all that pooled up water. So the potential of getting additional water, which is now a pond, and turning into a lake down there is, you can imagine, I mean, just for you guys, just like for you folks, would be a big concern.
You're stuck between a wet rock and a wet, hard place.
Exactly. Thank you very much.
Don't want to exacerbate that situation anymore with any more water.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
I just had a comment on just looking at the grading. I really don't actually see any walkout conditions on the site. I see 4 and 5 feet of grade change max from where a house would be on those lots. So it appears that these are more likely lookouts than a full walkout basement. Because from the front of the buildable lot to approximately where the house would be, because it's not taking the full box, there's probably only 4 feet of grade change. So it's not really going to be a full
depth.
Without having a section drawn, but from what I can see from reading.
Without carving out a lower patio.
Right, without, yeah, exactly. Without putting up sidewalls along the edge of the house and carving into the hillside, you really wouldn't, per se.
I suppose the easy answer would be, and you're correct, that's absolutely correct. I believe there might be the ability to do a walkout on some of the lots that are further in, but if we were limited to just doing lookouts on those lots, we'd be comfortable with that, because it's not our intent to basically carve out and create
right.
Something which shouldn't be. In terms of the view of the house, I think that helps to address that. Yeah, the tops of the foundations are going to be where the tops of the foundations are going to be, just like any site. We're not going to build them up 5 feet above the curb. We can't. The engineering staff won't let us do it. It's the purpose of having a site development plan to make sure that people don't do that. It doesn't help us with the trees if we do that either, because it could have an impact on them. So, the incorporation of the berm, by the way, with all due respect to the Brinkerhoffs, I would be just as concerned if I had, you know, enjoyed the woodlands for many, many years, and suddenly there's a house being built there. Unfortunately, the nature of living in the suburbs is you sometimes have to look at your neighbor, and so it's really a function of what we're going to do is soften that and provide privacy. We certainly have done that in agreeing to take out native planting that's there, admittedly not the best planting in the world, and replace that with a berm and with new landscaping. In time, that will certainly help to soften that. So, I can't stand here today and tell you that we're going to put ranch houses there so that a neighbor doesn't see it from a second floor window, but I do respect and understand, and we will do what we can to work with the Brinkerhoffs. But there's only so much I can do. As far as the fence is concerned, honestly, I talked with staff about that earlier today, and at first I was resistant to it because I didn't see any purpose. But honestly, it doesn't hurt anything. It's a minor thing to do. It's not going to adversely affect the development from an aesthetic standpoint. We're not trying to put a trail there. I don't have an issue putting a fence there. If staff agrees that a split rail fence is there, I'm already putting enough split rail fence in here as it is, with a few more feet of split rail fence.
And honestly, a split rail fence doesn't prevent anybody from doing anything. It just there. It defines space.
That's all it does. And I honestly can't imagine a scenario where, well, we had this argument earlier on today, where kids will ever go there. But you know what? The fact is, kids are going to go where kids are going to go. Okay. So again, I'm not going to dispute that. A fence is a very simple, easy thing to do to provide some extra level of comfort for our neighbors. As far as the flow of water, Mr. Brinkerhoff is correct. They're downstream. It just happens to be the way it is. This is the way the water flows. I'm not an engineer. I don't have my engineer with me tonight, but I'm fairly certain he would say that it's incumbent upon us as the developers to make sure that we don't, we have to hold that water and release it downstream. So rain gardens, whatever we have to do is fine. I think rain gardens are basically a waste of time. But we'll work with staff because, I mean, clearly if there's a method for us to be able to soften that blow and to divert it, we'll do it. We just can't change the natural flow of water, and I think everybody knows that. As far as the sidewalk is concerned, that's going to be compacted gravel. It'll be pervious. So, I mean, it's not like we're creating more of a hazard. We're basically providing what is required, which is to have a accessible pathway around that pond for maintenance purposes. And that's all I have to say. Sure.
One is, when you said, which is true, natural flow of water is natural flow of water, and you're not impacting that. But I think really the question that's being asked is not contesting that's where the water's been going and will go, but what you're intending to do from an engineering perspective, and correct me if I'm wrong, is not to increase the flow of water there to create the other conditions that they're concerned about.
That's correct.
Okay. And that's what I'm assuming staff and Dave, et cetera, have looked at and are comfortable that that's the case?
That's correct. We have met with the adjacent property owners as well as Krakauer and Associates and looked at that extensively. I'm not an engineer, but...
Fair enough.
Okay. Yes.
So the question is, and I don't know the answer to this, is it? What if it turns out, and this is all constructed, that we had the best intentions, but it's not working? What happens?
Like what has happened, you mean, with the road construction?
Yeah.
Shoulder
right.
issue?
That's the example. I know what to do about that one. I don't know what to do about this one.
With regards to this one, I mean, and kind of speaking in kind of a vacuum of mm-hmm. to how it's going to be incumbent upon the village to work with the developer, or depending on the timing of the occurrence, the HOA, to take a really close look at how the detention is working. You know, that's why it's incumbent upon us to make sure the HOA maintains the detention, to make sure it works properly, not just this year or next year, but throughout the life of the development. And that ultimately, you know, if it's done, the goal is that there won't be an issue. Now, if for some reason the detention, I mean, that's why we're going through and the engineering is going to be detailed, so that we have, you know, as close to as we can as insurance that it will perform. If for some reason it doesn't, we'll certainly, that will be then time to look at what we can do as it relates to the wetland and the Army, and involving the Army Corps, as to how we can make sure that we're not impacting the wetland, but we're also not impacting the adjacent property owner.
I'm assuming that there's going to be some sort of construction bonds are going to be put up for this project for development purposes. And if it doesn't work, am I once again correct that the village will take an action that the developer will have to make it work or put their bonds at risk?
That's correct. I mean, we won't approve any construction until engineering has been finalized, and that Public Works, and specifically because Dave Brown is a certified stormwater manager, that he is comfortable that the detention will work.
Okay. So the answer is a bad word. So the response is maybe a better word for purposes of what was brought up. I'm going to mispronounce it. Brinkerhoff, one and two, is that the engineering being presented by the developer for purposes of approval has to be approved so as to not exacerbate or increase the flow of water and create these additional adverse conditions on adjacent property. And if it doesn't work for whatever reason, once you start putting it in, the village, through its enforcement mechanism, will be able to address it either A, with the developer if they're still there, or B, with the homeowners association. Because nobody can take their water and just put it on someone else's property without effectively their permission, to a greater extent than the natural flow.
I would add that these principles for design, these requirements for design, have been applied, and they're typically over-designed to accommodate these conditions. I have complete faith in my engineer, and I have just as much faith in the village's engineer to work proactively to meet that requirement. So we recognize that burden's on us. We recognize that it's our surety that's at risk. So,
right.
And I can assure you that sometime before the first house is occupied, that detention pond will be tested. Because the detention pond's first thing to go in when we develop. We clear the site and we put the detention in.
Okay. And then you indicated that this fencing on lot between lots 18 and 19, that's not an issue, so you'll work with staff to do whatever needs to be done there. I think I got the lot numbers right.
Well, as long as it's not fencing the whole subdivision.
No. Yeah. I don't think that's what they're asking.
Yeah. Right. Just that area.
Okay.
Right.
And then this question about the lots 19 through 22, the four that sit immediately north of the Brinkerhoff residence. Once again, I'm neither an engineer nor an architect, but what I heard was, unless you do substantial excavation, you're not putting walkouts there.
That's correct. You only have so much slope to work with.
Okay, so you're not going to try to change the entire character of those lots to accommodate walkouts.
No.
If that's the case, is it appropriate, and is it something that you would consider to have, although walkouts are allowed in certain, if it can work, but not on those lots?
Yeah, I, in fact, if I didn't make the statement, I should have, but it's in my notes, that to limit that to those lots as just, in fact, I said it actually, to just lookout lots.
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
So the answer is yes.
Okay. So limit. Did I miss anything that you were talking about?
I just want to say there's no, because my village attorney is ringing my head.
Uh-huh.
There's no guarantee that detention will solve everything.
No. So, right. I understand.
Sure. I would also add on that detention pond, we recognize that we have a common interest to get that water to the creek as fast as possible. And I would even say, in future years, working with the homeowners association, to work with them for brush clearing and, you know, the kind of remedial maintenance kind of things to make sure, even if it meant the homeowner association contractor coming on our property to access those areas, that we would be amenable to those approaches just to get this thing squared away.
Okay, good.
Does that mean you want to annex in?
He did that, sir.
Okay. This is for you to maybe respond to, but more for the commission. In terms of the discussion regarding new or additional house elevations, the options, of course, are they can come back to the commission or they can be done through staff review consistent with the guidelines that have been expressed here and in whatever that document is called. Is there any feeling or consensus? Mine personally would be, because we're not talking about a tremendous number, and it's going to be, it's one builder, I guess you said?
Right, so we're one builder for the whole development.
So we're talking about one level of consistency. It's not a bunch of people coming in.
That's right.
That I personally feel comfortable with staff, but I don't know what everybody else feels with. Where do you want to see them?
I would like to see it come back to us with the, once the final builder is selected and we see their drawings.
At the very minimal, it would be as when the stylizing has been created, the style set has been created, at the very minimum, we need to see it at that point. The other thing is, this village doesn't really have an appearance review commission. So this is it as far as that kind of thing goes. So at the very minimum, maybe that's what we should state at this meeting, is that we need to see it when the builders have been selected.
Okay. Because the third motion that would be suggested this evening is preliminary and final approval of the architectural elevations. And as pointed out, we don't really have the architectural elevations. We have examples of concepts of architectural elevations.
That's a nice example.
Right. So what we would have to do is we'd have to, Joe, if this is okay, change it to, this is going to sound funny, but I guess it's conceivable, preliminary and final approval of the conceptual architectural evaluations, but subject to further review by the commission after
the builder's been
the builder's
of
selection?
The final product.
Of the final product.
Right.
Baron, you wrote that down, I hope.
So it's preliminary and final approval of the architectural conceptual elevations, subject to review by the Planning and Zoning Commission, after the builder has been approved.
As the builder's been selected and the product has been brought forward.
That'll probably be sooner than later.
Yeah, that's fine.
I guess just so everyone's aware, that will essentially create another layer within essentially village board approval. It wouldn't require a public hearing because it's just reviewing architecture, but it would require additional review by village board, and I would have to verify with our village attorney, but it also delay the final approval of the development until those built plans have been approved. So we could, it wouldn't stop it being from being reviewed by the village board as relates to sites, annexation, rezoning of the property, but in terms of final ordinance adoption, that would create that extra step to come back here.
Which is why I want to do it sooner than later.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then finally, we talked about this issue of a tree preservation plan versus this 3-to-1 ordinance obligation. And once again, we can live by the strict wording of the ordinances, or because this is a request for effectively a plan unit development, we can look instead to the development according to these conditions as well as the others that have been discussed of a tree preservation plan to address whatever trees, you know, come out and have to be replaced. So is there any feelings one way or the other? You know, since I was so persuasive on the last one, I'll tell you here, I'd be in favor of the tree preservation plan, but which means of course you'll vote for the ordinance. So does anybody have any thoughts on that?
From a staff perspective, I just want to state that right now the preservation plan calls for a 3-to-1 replacement ratio. So if one tree is removed that is deemed to be in good health, that isn't impacted by construction activities,
three additional trees need to be planted, typically at for one tree, or it's say for instance one tree, but it's a 42 diameter tree, 42 trees need to be planted. That creates
a
large burden on the developer that and
the
also
village,
given
frankly.
Given
yeah.
the site,
mm-hmm.
I'm not sure where those trees would go. So I think it's a balancing act.
Your backyard.
Of preserving trees, but also understanding that there is going to be a significant number of trees that will have to be removed as part of this development.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, I think, consistent with most developments, but I just want to make sure that it's understood at the commission level that, you know, there will be a large amount of trees that will be removed
mm-hmm.
because of the nature of the roadway and building construction.
But you'll create a specific plan for this development versus just a strict application of the ordinance.
Correct.
Is the option.
It would be, on a, and I think it says, to indicate on a lot by lot basis,
right, yeah.
we'd review
okay.
each tree and,
okay.
yep.
Okay. So any thoughts?
The only one that I had was the number three that we modified.
Oh, well, yeah, in terms of modification, number three we modified that was conditioned for approval, that it is to accommodate the improver at 45 rather than on the center point of the property line for the berm.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's still kind of this open question on one and two regarding ordinance versus fencing, et cetera, that I think's got to get worked out still.
Right, in terms of what how it runs and how high it is and
the 36 yeah. inches,
right.
all that kind
right,
of
right,
stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
And number seven being
yes.
more variety.
More variety and consistent with the village ordinance, and then even though there's not a technical parkway on one side of the street, it's within whatever would be the equivalent
right
of way
right
parkway.
Right.
Did we settle on number four?
Oh.
Kind of goes with number three, doesn't it?
I believe what was identified was the fact that there is going to be a fence that's on the top of the berm,
right.
but then there's a question of property line and HOA, common area maintenance.
The question goes back, I think the original purpose of this committee when we discussed this was that where the 6-foot fence on top was to block headlights, the lights and things
sound.
Like that. So the other fence on the property lines, I think, is a completely different issue.
Right.
I think you still need the fence on top of the berm to address the issue that we brought forward
we agree.
Last time.
Right, we agree.
But the fence to define the property could really just be defining open space in between the property and the fence on the berm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And then that would be up to the HOA to determine how that would be maintained, that open space?
Yes.
I mean, they could possibly say that the space between the property lines and the berm fence are similar to that big thing in the middle of
right.
the property.
Yeah.
So.
Mm-hmm.
And address it that way.
Okay.
Okay.
So I don't have a problem with that.
So for purposes of conditions of approval, conditions one and two, I think we're really saying have to be reevaluated with staff to be consistent with whatever the ordinances are and whatever is required, for instance, if you want an in-ground pool, et cetera.
Correct.
So those have to be reevaluated. Three has been revised that the landscape berm on 45 on these particular property lots it's the landscape berm is not on the center point. It's behind it.
That's correct.
But that berm will accommodate the improved Route 45 as we know it today.
That's correct.
Okay. Four, I guess, we've left. Seven, we're changing. The parkway trees are consistent with village ordinance. And on the non-sidewalk side, we'll be within the equivalent right-of-way area.
Correct.
Okay. Then we've added 14, which you've agreed to work with staff and with the adjacent property owner regarding the fencing between lots 18 and 19.
Correct.
15, it is really just a reaffirmation that you're going to work with engineering, both with the village, your own, and also coordinate with the property owner, that this natural flow is not increased to an extent to create an exacerbation of a water condition, which you have to do anyways, to the extent you can. Right. 16 is you.
No, can you repeat that?
No.
Okay.
Yes. You're going to work with your engineer, staff, and the adjacent property owner to the extent necessary so we can have a level of engineering comfort that the overland water flow on the adjacent property owner, it's really probably the south portion of that site, is not increased. In other words, the engineering works.
Correct.
Right. Okay. And which you have to, anyways. Quite candidly, so it's just an affirmation.
I'm basically agreeing to something I already have to agree
That's with. Right, yeah. 16, you've agreed to limit on lots 19 through 22 that they can have either The most thing you have is a lookout basement, no walkouts there.
That's more than reasonable.
Okay, and then 17, we've discussed that it would be the lot by lot tree preservation plan versus the more general ordinance application.
Correct.
Okay, did I miss anything, anybody?
The one thing I would say in regards to items 1 and 2, I just would open the idea up of adding language in there saying subject to state and local ordinances. I think that covers both the restriction on 36 inches while also being mindful that there may be items that supersede our ability to restrict the fence. But I do recognize that there was a discussion that is kind of left outstanding as relates to pools that,
right,
if the commission wants to address again, we can certainly do that. This is one way to kind of do both, but again, it's up to.
I just find it really odd that the state and local government would want to take the responsibility to determine the height of those fences when it's really going to be a suit that is protected by insurance that is going to determine the height of that fence.
Well, local governments have tort immunity, so there's that. Otherwise, it's.
It's just a commentary.
So are we keeping 2 in or not?
We are.
2 we're keeping in, but there's going to be a question of height and things like that.
Question on what?
On height, et cetera.
Okay.
Right.
How does it address that piece of property that we just talked about, the 6-foot fence on the berm? So according to this, each one of those homes, the rear of their house would be a split rail fence if that's declared open space?
Just on the open space, the area to the that backs up to the high quality wetland, and then the center portion would have the split rail fence. The only dispute is whether that should be 36 or 42 inches.
But lots 19 through 22 don't back up on open space.
That's correct.
Nor do 23 through 32, because that's the roadway.
We're not planning an offense there.
Right.
Actually, to clarify, 19 through 22 do back up to open space because that berm is open space.
So this is open
technically space. He's correct.
So, and that's the question that this has, is we just had this discussion about the 23 to 32, the 6-rail fence, and then we were talking about are you going to call that open space between the back of the lots and that fencing, and if it is, then they would be required to put a split rail fence in.
It's a good point. I think that we would exclude that because I don't see any point in having a split rail fence or, unless the Brickerhoffs feel that,
So what you're suggesting is that split rail fence can be installed along all lots with side or rear yard adjacent to open space other than lots 19 through 22, actually it's 19 through 32.
That's correct. I was going to make that point.
Right?
That's correct.
Okay.
There's a different standard for lots, and I can't see the numbers from here, but the lots that are backing up to.
You're wanting none of these.
Right, but the lots that back up to Buffalo Grove Road and Route 45 will have the stockade fence, or not the stockade, the cedar fence.
Right, but on the berm, not on their property line.
Correct.
Right. Okay. All right. Anything else?
Nope.
Okay. We have a standing. Any other comments you'd like to make?
None for me. No.
Okay.
I'm going to keep my mouth shut.
Okay. All right. We have a standing motion on this commission to approve. I'm sorry.
I have one question.
Yes.
I noticed on the landscape plan that was presented tonight, or in our packet, that I just want to clarify this, that the sidewalk going north from your entrance on Buffalo Grove Road to Route 45, there's a sidewalk there, right?
Would you repeat that? I'm sorry.
No.
Going north from your entrance off of Buffalo Grove Road.
It's just outside.
From your entrance to up to Route 45. Is there a sidewalk there?
There is an existing sidewalk there.
There is a sidewalk there that's an existing sidewalk, but the sidewalk that we're proposing, I recall, was going around the outer perimeter. Actually, here, let me just point to it. It would go here.
I think he's talking about the connection along going north right there. See, it's not in the landscape plan.
There's nothing here on the landscape plan. There is a sidewalk to the south of that road.
I don't believe there is a sidewalk north of that.
There is a pathway system.
There is a sidewalk there? There is?
Yeah.
It's in the right of way. It's in
Do you know, I believe there's a sidewalk that runs along Route 45 as well.
It's on the Pearson Brown drawings.
It's on some of the drawings, but not all.
It's not a landscape drawing, but it's on the Pearson Brown drawings. And the engineering drawings supersede everything.
So you're going to retain the sidewalk is the answer?
Correct.
Okay.
I'm not going to take it out.
Right. Okay.
I can't control what the state does, but.
No, right. Okay. All right. So we have a standing motion to recommend approval. Our first motion would be to recommend to approve as part of the special use permit for a planned unit development variations pertaining to FAR on a lot-by-lot basis as described in the FAR matrix for Woodland Chase subdivision dated March 31, 2016, subject to what we've now discussed are the revised and additional conditions 1 through 17. Okay, so we need a second for that.
Second.
Okay, any discussion?
The only discussion is that I have is the only comment I have, excuse me, is that I still think the FAR is too excessive for this development. Centennial Farms may have a high FAR, but that was developed as a cityscape development. This is not proposed to be that, so I'm opposed to the FAR.
Yeah. Anybody else? My only comments are the same as I had last time. I am a little concerned about the FAR, but I can quote unquote live with it based upon your representations of the actual sizes of the homes. If every home was 4,200 square feet, it'd be problematic. I personally do like sidewalks, so I'm a little bit disappointed they aren't on the inside. You know, but I said that last time too. So anybody else? Okay, we need a roll call.
Commissioner Ballou?
Yes.
Commissioner Cotton? Commissioner Hesner?
Yes.
Commissioner Heidner?
No.
Commissioner Mulcrone?
Yes.
Commissioner Gorog? Chairman Morris?
Yes. Okay. Secondly, we have a motion to recommend preliminary and final site and landscape plan approvals subject to conditions 1 through 17 as they've been articulated this evening and amended that we've already talked about. And we need a second for that.
I'll second that.
Okay. Any discussion on the site and landscape plan approvals? Okay. We need a vote on that.
Commissioner Cotton? Commissioner Hesner?
Yes.
Commissioner Heidner?
Yes.
Commissioner Mulcrone?
Yes.
Commissioner Grog? Chairman Morris?
Yes.
Commissioner Ballou?
Yes.
Okay. Lastly, we have a motion to recommend preliminary and final approval, which sounds a little funny, of the architectural conceptual elevations and, I guess it's the final signage plans, subject to architectural review after the builder is selected and the product is brought forward. We need a second for that.
Second.
Okay, any discussion on that? Okay, we need a roll call for that, please.
Commissioner Heidner?
Yes.
Commissioner Mulcrone?
Yes.
Commissioner Grog? Chairman Morris?
Yes.
Commissioner Ballou?
Yes.
Commissioner Cotton? Commissioner Hesner?
Yes.
Okay. Anything else we can do for anyone this evening? Okay, we appreciate everything. Sorry. Thank you. Okay, thank you. All right, we have now the minutes of, well, I suppose, we have any development review or discussions we need to talk about?
Sure, just real briefly. So we have a Planning and Zoning Commission on April 27th. That is to discuss the Sam's Club fueling station, as well as the McAllister's Deli, which is located at the former Famous Dave's property. That involves a rezoning as well as a special use to allow a drive-through. It's an OR&D. It's always been a grandfathered use. However, because the property has been vacant for, I believe, 2 years, that has been sunsetted. So then now, because of the proposal, they're now looking for a rezoning, which staff is very agreeable to, because for as long as anyone can remember, it's been a restaurant. Otherwise, we've had several concept reviews involving a house of worship that is still awaiting technical review. The Cuneo property with the 128 single family homes is still awaiting technical review response. And last night, there was a discussion of allowing a children's recreational facility of a trampoline type park and tactical laser tag adjacent to the Park District Fitness Center and the Police Department, so I believe it's 730 Lakeview. It's the former Nostalgia Homes, and they're proposing to utilize that 49,000 square feet of space for these gigantic trampolines as well as laser tag and some other amenities.
Is that where the kitty bounce house place was before?
I don't believe so. I mean, Blast Zone still exists, and I believe that's off of...
there was another one.
Oh, there was another one?
Next to the ice rink.
Jump along or hop up, jump along, something like that, which was right next to the ice arena.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah.
This is not the same building.
Is that the same building?
I have to double check.
That was, a multi-use building, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. This one's Nostalgia was one.
It has a slate roof and a brick. Yeah.
Wasn't there a dog sitting in there?
Could have been too.
Dog daycare? Yeah.
I don't know what was before Nostalgia Homes. I'd have to verify. The board was okay with them going to concept or technical review. They did have some concerns that relates to parking. Per the code, it's 1 per 1,000 square feet for a recreational space. However, and so it meets it, there's no variation required, but they still have concerns because there's no other, the adjacent property owners, you know, are using their space. And so the likelihood of a shared parking, either by the police department, by us, or by the park district, is not something we count on. And so it's be very incumbent upon them to provide their own parking. And that's a concern that the board has.
Even though they meet code?
Even though they meet code, that's correct.
Okay.
So that's something that they will have to address and verify that the amount will be allowed. Involving the northeast corner of Milwaukee and Town Line, that's the Regency Melody Farm development, that's still undergoing technical review. I'm not sure exactly when we'll have enough materials to be ready for applying zoning commission. However, I would anticipate that being a May or June date, subject to your availability and staff's.
I've got a question about, you said the Cuneo property development, the residential development, is that what you're talking about?
Yes, I'm sorry. The 128 single family homes that Pulte Homes is proposing.
Technical review?
Oh, it's not in technical review yet. We're awaiting waiting them to submit plans, which we believe will happen within the next several weeks, but we've not received anything yet.
And then I'm assuming that Westfield sold the mall since their signs are all covered up.
Yes, they sold the mall. They do maintain a minority ownership in the mall. However, it's owned now by a group called Centennial. I don't have a lot of details about them right now. John and I have plans to meet with them for lunch to discuss their operations, but I believe it's more of an investment group that purchased the property.
A U.S. group versus Australia?
You know, I'm not sure what kind of accent they have.
So you don't know whether they have any future plans to fill in some of the restaurant space that, I mean, the movie theater was supposed to have all these restaurants and there's nothing there.
So there's two that are supposed to be there. One is initially a BZ's Twisted Cuisine, which is not happening, and it's currently going through a ownership transition to Centennial and Westfield. The other item is a group called Tucano's, which is a Brazilian steak place. That is still moving forward. I believe they're appearing before the Liquor and License Commission fairly soon, but that is moving forward. And the Uncle Julio's, which was previously approved, is they're scheduling themselves to be open by April 12th.
April 12th?
April 12th.
I thought it said 26.
It's a couple days.
Or is it 26? 26.
Six days?
I was about to say, it's probably changed because I know we haven't gone through final inspections, but updated their sign.
Okay.
Is the parking lot going to be available for them?
I mean, it's like been resurfaced. And
but aren't they still working on Northwestern there?
I believe. I believe that's intended to be completed, but that will be something they're going to have to work out between themselves and likely Centennial.
Okay. Want to be parking across the street?
Right.
Maybe the new owners will have a different opinion.
Like we said.
Okay.
Hey, well, maybe the new owners will be more receptive. Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Okay, we need to approve the minutes of February 17th. Any comments to those? Anyone?
I'll second.
Okay, all in, we can just by acclamation, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Anyone opposed?
One abstention.
Okay, that one passes. We need to approve the minutes of February 24th. Any comments on that one?
Yeah, page four. It talks about under, right after the motion there, it says subject to the conditions above, and actually the conditions are written below it.
Okay.
And.
So close.
Close. Did you find it? After the
yep.
motion, after the vote. There.
Okay. So it's above.
Below.
Oh, below.
Okay. Okay.
And then I think I made the motion vote. On page 6C.
Yeah.
It says Chairman Morrison. Actually, I was.
Yeah, I came in
Chairman.
Late. Okay, got that.
I think that was it.
Okay. We need a second for that?
Second as amended.
Okay.
Second as amended.
Okay. Acclamation, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Anyone opposed? Okay, those are passed. If we have nothing else, with the motion to adjourn, we need a second.
Second.
All in favor of that one?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, we're adjourned. Good night.
Use mine signing that real quick.
Sure.
Oh, sure.